walk through a storm, hold your head up high, and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm is a
Well, good afternoon. Thank you for being here today to remember and celebrate the life of CJ. I think it is so very CJ to have timed this so as to celebrate him on Super Bowl Sunday. And I also feel a little tinge of guilt as I read his obituary there on the inside of your worship program, because it's the first time I've ever seen in print his age. God knows I never heard it from his lips. And so there it is, saying how long he was with us. I'm glad it was such a long and joyful life. He brought joy to so many of us. So thank you for being here as we remember and celebrate this very special life. Would you please read some of these scripture verses with me responsively? I'll be one, you be all. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last, the Redeemer will stand upon the earth. After my awakening, the Redeemer will raise me up, and in my body, I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold the one who is my friend, and not a stranger. If we have life, we have life in the Lord. And if we die, we die in the Lord. So then whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors.
God is with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose mercies cannot be numbered, accept our prayers on behalf of your servant CJ and grant him an entrance into the land of light and joy in the communion of all saints through Christ. Amen.
Our first reading is from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster, and their going from us to be their destruction. But they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. They will receive great good because God found them worthy. Those who trust in God will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with God in love. because grace and mercy are upon God's holy ones, and God watches over those whom God has chosen. In these human words, God's voice is heard.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading comes from the Roman philosopher Seneca. In the presence of death, we must continue to sing the song of life. We must be able to accept death and go from its presence better able to bear our burdens and to lighten the load of others. Out of our sorrows should come understanding. Through our sorrows, we join with all of those before who have had to suffer and all of those who will yet have to do so. Let us not be gripped by the fear of death. If another day be added to our lives, let us joyfully receive it. But let us not anxiously depend on our tomorrows. Though we grieve the deaths of our loved ones, we accept them and hold on to our memories as precious gifts. Let us make the best of our loved ones while they are with us, and let us not bury our love with death. In these human words, God's voice is heard.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise as you are able.
As declared in the fourth gospel. Everything that Abba God gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away. And this is the will of the one who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that has been given to me, but raise it up on the last day. May God add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of this sacred text.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Your soul.
We will have some very distinguished guests sharing their stories and remembrances in just a couple of minutes. But we always like to say a word in general at these times to speak something that is meant to be spiritual or theological or philosophical or profound or something. It's usually meaningless. But we feel the need to do something. I mean, how can you say something meaningful about a whole life? How can you say something meaningful about the footprint, the fingerprint left on the world by someone? And so we say things because we have to do something. And yet we realize the life we honor and remember and bless today is so much bigger than anything that can be said. And still we try. Most of the things that I would like to share with you about CJ and our experience together and our friendship and our working together, modesty and decency just will not allow me to do it. And I see that you have similar stories, so why bother? He was so much fun and squeezed so much out of life. So what can I say? Theological, profound, ministerial, pastoral, what can I say? And I have some stories in the Bible that I usually go to in moments like this, and none of them seem to fit CJ. And then I remembered Isaac.
Who?
Isaac, the bartender on the Love Boat. And in the Bible, Isaac. And at the end of his life, he gave Jacob a blessing. But supposedly, the blessing was meant for Esau. And Isaac mistakenly gave the blessing, he thought, to the wrong person. But I think his biggest mistake was in thinking that he only had one blessing to give. And so that's what came to my mind when I was thinking about how to honor CJ today. I think it came to my mind because CJ, unlike Isaac, knew perfectly well that he had many blessings to give, and he gave them. CJ and I played a lot, and we played pretty rough. I think people, especially new people, when they would see us playing, thought maybe there was animosity. There was no animosity. That's just how we had a good time. And our verbal banter could get pretty blue, and that's what we love most about it. But as ribald and silly as we got, when it was time for worship, he showed reverence for the altar, for the crucifix, for the communion elements. He even called me, 40 years his junior, father. 37 years. And that was, a little uncomfortable in the early years for me, but I came to receive it as a term of endearment and affection and respect. And that solemnity that he could offer in the midst of all his play, that was one of his gifts. And of course, outside of worship, he might also call me father, or Darrell, or reverend, or sis. How he could effortlessly move from formality to camp was another gift that he shared. His cooking, his humor, his making of vestments. Dear Jesus, I'm going to have to buy my vestments now. His faithfulness to give contributions to the treasury. His dedication to the sacristy. His willingness to be part of the visitation ministry. His complete sincerity in telling the people he loved that he loved them. These were just some of the blessings that CJ gave, and gave with absolute selflessness. Isaac didn't know that he could give lots of blessings, but CJ figured it out. And we are all richer because he shared his gifts with us. We love and miss you, CJ. May your memory bless all who hold it. Amen. Please welcome now his friend, Gregory Ullman.
We are here to honor the memory of Charles J. Ashton, whom we all knew as CJ. I'm going to talk a little bit about the chronology of his life and then a little bit about our friendship. He was born in 1929 in Ansonia, Connecticut, which is a small town near New Haven. He was born into a traditional Italian Roman Catholic family, two brothers, one sister, stern father, loving mother. He graduated from high school in that town with honors and intended to study at Pratt Institute in New York City. But fate intervened and he was drafted into the Army during the Korean conflict. He served for 2 years as a medic in the Army, and then when he got out, he got additional training and became an X-ray technician. He lived in Houston initially, and then he moved to New York City to be with his brother, Frank, and he moved in with his brother, Frank, in New York. He worked for 8 years in the medical field, including at one time managing a clinic for the Longshoremen's Union. He eventually decided to go back and study design, and he did so, and he developed his own interior design practice. It thrived. During that period, he met Raymond Payne, who was a beautician, and they quickly developed a relationship, and they lived together effectively as spouses for over 20 years. They lived on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. CJ was both seriously and jokingly the interior designer to the stars. His clients included Frankie Valli of the Four Seasons, Lonnie Anderson, and many others. Their business was so successful that at one point they bought a summer home in Connecticut and redesigned it. And CJ's work made Architectural Digest a feat that he was very proud of, and he always kept this on his coffee table, that his work was featured in that magazine. So CJ was in the Manhattan in the 1960s. And this was the time, 1969, of the Stonewall Riots, which, for those of you who don't know your LGBT history, it was a seminal event in which the patrons of a bar that was typically raided by the police decided one night to resist, and a small riot ensued, and it's the same thing over the next few days. So I asked CJ, I said, you were there, what did you think of this? And he said, well, I thought these protesters were riffraff. He said, you know, they were sort of troublemakers. And you can forgive him for that because he lived in a different sort of rarefied upper Manhattan world. But if you also look at it from a different perspective, here we were in the 1960s. CJ was living openly with his male spouse. We all know CJ. He never took gruff from anyone. And so you could say that sometimes the bravest political act is to live your own life boldly and openly, which is what CJ always did. He started a second design office in Los Angeles, and then when Raymond contracted HIV/AIDS in the early 1980s, they moved out there. He took care of Raymond until he died, and as I said, they were together for 20 years, which is a story in and of itself. CJ did become politically active in Los Angeles. He got involved in what was called the Christopher Street West Committee, which was the organizer of the equivalent of Los Angeles' version of the New York City Gay Pride Parade. So he actually served on their board for 10 years. I found this newspaper article, pictures from the event, and of course, you know, this is a go-go boy, and that's a go-go boy, and these are all go-go boys down here. But here's CJ up in the corner. And my guess is that CJ did a lot of work to organize this event, and that he probably knew about half these guys also. That's who he was. He served on that board for 9 years, and during this period, he met Troy Perry. Troy Perry was the organizer, one of the organizers of this, of the congregation of which this church is a member. It's sort of like a refugee church for people who, for those who really don't fit or are not welcome in their own churches. And CJ wrote in his own words later on, I immediately knew that this is what I needed and wanted in my life. And he was active and served on that board for many years. I met CJ in 2005 after he moved to South Florida. I was taking Grant's class on New Thought Religion. We would sit around a conference table. CJ would bring little pieces of candy, Hershey's Kisses and things like that. And he would sit next to me and he would put one in front of me And, you know, I'm easy. I would take it and eat it. And then a few minutes later, he'd put another one. And then a few minutes later, he would put another one. And eventually, I sort of had enough candy. But he didn't stop. And so then I would start looking at them for a few minutes and then putting them back in front of him. And then he would wait and put them back in front of me. We were sort of lucky we didn't get kicked out of the class. But CJ and Grant were best friends, and occasionally they would ask me to have dinner with them afterwards. And so we did. And I became friends with Grant, but CJ and I basically became best buddies. And since that time, I would say not a week went by, almost, that we never got together, either for a movie or for dinner or to go to the bars or to do something, because CJ liked to do things. It's hard to say what cements a friendship. I thought he was charming, intelligent, funny. He always had a positive outlook. He made me laugh. He made me look at the world in a different way. He was funny in restaurants. If you ever ate with him, he would stop and talk to the people at the different tables as you were either heading in or heading out. And he would lean over to complete strangers and say, "Oh, ma'am, what a lovely dress you're wearing," or "What a beautiful couple you make," or what a lovely daughter you have. And he would maybe sometimes do this for two or three different tables. It would take a long time to get to the door. And I was sort of fascinated by this. I thought maybe people would get annoyed, but they never did. He was a deacon here, and he would wear his collar after church. And one day we had brunch in Wilton Manors. And next to us, there was a table with about a dozen women. I think they were celebrating someone's birthday. And one of them came over and said, "Father, will you give me a blessing?" And CJ was very somber and serious, and he said, "Of course." And he said, "Bless you, my daughter." And then she went back. And then another one came over from the table and essentially said the same thing. And he went through, he did the same thing. And then a third woman came over and she said, "You know, my mother is sick, and could you please pray with me and give me a blessing?" And so, of course, he did. So after this happened about four or five times, I was starting to get just a little annoyed. And I said, "You know, CJ, they think you're a priest." And he said, he just smiled in the way CJ smiles, and he said, "Well, I'm a chaplain, and it's okay." And of course, it was okay, and the blessing that they received from CJ with its spirituality and love was just as good as any blessing they would have, I think, that they would have received from any priest. In the closing days of his life, I was talking to one of the nurses, and they said it's so sad when they die, when someone goes without family. And of course, that's not true in CJ's case. He did have family. He was part of my family. He came to birthdays. He came to us. He was with us for Christmas. He even officiated at my sister's wedding. And then there were Chuck and Sue, who considered him family, Tim and Veronica, Dominic Manzelli, who's here, who knew him for over 40 years when he was part of his Rat Pack in New York and Los Angeles. And then there's also Howard and of course, Lovey and her family. And there was Howard and Maxine Abner, who were friends of his for 45 years in New York, and he designed several homes for them. They had planned to be here today, but they had to leave. And so please bear with me. They asked me to read a short letter that they prepared. Each of us here today will remember CJ in their own way. Our memories are over 45 years of fun, laughter, and general craziness. He was known to our grandchildren as Papa CJ, and he loved that title. My daughters have wonderful memories of growing up with him. He danced with them. He was a great dancer, checked on their boyfriends, went to their weddings, and cared for them like an uncle. Our daughter Karen remembers him as a bright and special light. She wrote, "His spirit will always be with us. I have priceless memories of you, Mom, dancing around our pool table with CJ, singing Tea for Two at the top of your lungs. And at Harris's bar mitzvah, swinging his jacket over his head when he decided to do a striptease. Thank you for making him part of our family." Our daughter Leslie said, "I am so happy he was part of our lives." One of our granddaughters remembers that he was fun and loving, and she kept a picture of her and CJ in her room for many years. We think our 19-year-old grandson Harris expressed it best when he said, "CJ was one of the kindest, most loving people I have ever met. Knowing him from such a young age taught me to appreciate life and to be happy. He always had such joy in the way he lived. I have never met someone as genuine and unafraid to be himself. Howard and I will be reminded every day of CJ because he designed our homes. Every fabric and piece of furniture is there for us to remember him. We love you, CJ. Rest in peace." And then finally, in terms of family, I would just like to say one word, and that is that in the final months of his life, there was someone who took him to all of his doctor's appointments, who attended to all of his needs, who supervised his medical staff. And initially, she was just a neighbor, but she was also his dear friend. And that is Sandy Bates, who is here today. And if I think CJ deserved a guardian angel, and in Sandy, he received it. So it's hard to sum up a relationship, and I will sort of try to do so briefly. If I had to rank all of the people I have known in terms of their general wackiness and unconventionality, I think CJ would probably be pretty close to the top of the list. But if I also had to rank all of my friends in terms of their spirituality and solemnity and respect for the church, CJ would be at the top of that list too. And I think it is the sort of apparent contradiction between his irreverence on the one hand and his reverence on the other that made CJ such a fascinating and unique individual. But that's that, and I think at this point, all we can say is that we loved CJ. CJ loved us. We are better for having had him in our lives, and heaven is a better place now that he is there.
Also here to share some remembrances is the Honorable Commissioner Dean Trantalis.
Thank you, Durrell. Good afternoon, everybody. The few words I have to say today will not be as deep or as eloquent as you just heard from Mr. Ullman. And they were very beautiful, and certainly you shared many loving moments with CJ. Many of you probably don't know that CJ's real name is not Ashton. His last name was Asciutto. And while he tried to take the Italian out of his name, you couldn't take the Italian out of CJ. He was definitely one expressive individual, as we heard today. I knew CJ for many, many years, actually, although he moved here in more recently. But I became friends with his nephew. He had a nephew that lived in the same area that I did in the 80s. And CJ's brother also lived in the same complex. And that's how I got to know the family. And since I was from Connecticut, they were from Connecticut, so we had a little bit of a bond there. But his nephew, Lewis, was a singer, entertainer, and unfortunately, he too died from HIV, one of the early victims of that disease. So when CJ came into my life later on, we had a lot to talk about, a lot to cry over, but it seems like he came back to this community looking for a home. And not just a physical house, but I think he was seeking out a new family or one to augment the one he had. And I think that his finding the Sunshine Cathedral was definitely a place where he could call home. And he was indeed a very solemn and devoted individual. And I think all that training probably started in his young age as a Catholic. But he found this place to be specifically a place where he could feel comfortable and that he could add to the richness that it provided. Now, I also want to thank those who put this program together to put me before Reverend Grant Ford, because I don't know about you folks, but if you've ever been in the sanctuary before and have heard Grant speak, it's not an act you want to follow. But this is a community. We all share in this community. I've been in this community for almost 36 years myself and watched it grow. And, you know, CJ was born in the late 20s, so you can imagine growing up as a gay individual, a gay man, what it was like in the 30s and the 40s and the 50s. So we're talking about an individual who lived through the evolution of the LGBT experience. And I think in his later years, he finally got to appreciate the refreshing moment that we've all created in this world to allow people to feel free and open and expressive. And he certainly took advantage of that. And CJ, yes, he was all the things that you've heard this morning. CJ was loving, he embraced people. CJ had a quirky sense of humor. And as his lawyer, you probably think I know all of his secrets. There are no secrets with CJ. I appreciate being asked to speak here today. And I think that CJ is just one of those folks whose life experience we can all appreciate and understand. And if it weren't for him and his generation, we wouldn't be where we are today. Because it's the advances that he made, politically, socially, that allow us to be where we are and to be able to have an open and free church like we have here today. And I thank all those folks who participate in making this church what it is today, that allow us as a community to be as full and as complete as we are in the LGBT community here in Fort Lauderdale. So thank you.
Before I ask our next speaker to say some words, I'm reminded that CJ was given to outbursts. He loved to interrupt me when I was like maybe doing this. He would sit back there and say something. Just start talking to me. Yeah, just start talking to me, like, you know, and I would have to, you know, deal with it. And I would make jokes about it and feature it, and he loved that. And sometimes he wouldn't start it. Sometimes I would start it. And he still loved it. But why did that even come to me? Why am I even thinking about that right now? About 2 years ago, I stepped on my stole and a tassel fell off. And I asked CJ to put it back. I always ask, everything I'm wearing today, CJ made or mended or something. And so he did. Of course, he took it home. He came back. It's all perfect. Today, as I'm coming back to my seat to listen to Commissioner Chantella's talk, the CJ tassel fell off. I swear I hear him screaming at me from his seat back there. So anyway, my CJ tassel just fell off. The biggest tragedy about that is I have no idea how I'm going to get it reattached now, because CJ would be who I would go to. So CJ's dear friend, travel companion, instigator, co-conspirator, mentor, pastor, friend is here today. Of course, he's an icon in the community. He's my predecessor at this church, and someone very important to me. But we wanted him to have sort of the last word, as it is with CJ, because if anyone could, it would be him. So would you please welcome the Right Reverend Grant Linford.
Thank you so much. Forgive my voice, but I'm happy to tell you that the doctor told me yesterday, a new doctor, kind of cute too. He said, oh, he said, you'll be fine in another year. At 78, almost 79, you know, a year is like a lifetime to me, but here I am. We're here not to remember me, but to remember, let's see if I can get this right, Carlos Giuseppe Asciutto. Carlos Giuseppe. Whenever he would get out of line, well, not every time, I mean, that would be impossible, but occasionally I would call him that, you know, to remind him that at some point, several of the family changed Asciutto to Ashton. And I guess it was probably good for business when he became a decorator later. I don't know whether it ever legally changed or not, but I leave those things up to the lawyer, who is here, by the way. William Shakespeare said, a friend is one who knows you as you are, understands where you have been, accepts what you have become, and still gently allows you to grow. Well, CJ fits into almost all those except the gently part. He didn't know how to whisper. He had a sotto voce whisper. If he whispered to Keith over there, you could hear it over here. He was amazing. Studying for deacon. Deacons have to go through a classes here. They don't just, you know, make a deacon, right? Still. And he loved the classes, but he hated the reading. Marion reminded me of that because she was in one of the classes with him. Oh, he hated it. But he slogged through. He tried to, you know, to let me get him out of it. But I said, no, you got to do it. He slogged through because he was proud to serve the church. A sacristan, he started out as my dresser. Nobody has a dresser in church, you know, but I had one. It's like Broadway. Made all, if I wore anything that he didn't make, you don't want to know. But he was a wonderful friend. He was amazing. Traveler, traveled with us when we went, I think he went with us to China. He went with us to the Dominican Republic. He went with us to the trip to Italy with an Italian, a Sicilian nonetheless. Not an Italian, a Sicilian, who didn't speak very much. It was kind of a patois mix of Italian and Spanish and English and CJ. But he never met a stranger. And that was an amazing gift that he had. You're right. Going to dinner with him was a trial because you never knew when you're going to get to order. But travel with him in a strange country. Oh my. And he would, I remember in Rome, I'm not going to tell a lot of stories because I still worry about him. You might get me. But we were in Rome. And of course, he had to stop and talk to everybody. Well, you have a guide, and the guide was in front, and I was in the back to make sure, kind of shepherding everybody along. And I had the earphone on so I could hear what she was saying, as did we all. We lost CJ. He had stopped somewhere to talk to somebody, a total stranger sitting on the steps of a church. As we kept going, we had the Rome police looking for him. It started to rain. By the way, I ate the worst pizza in my life that night in Rome. Who knew? But I had the best further north. Okay, that's enough. We finally found him. Oh, he found his way back to the hotel, miraculously, and chewed me out for losing him. I said, wait a minute. Oh, he would spell. Until the next morning, and then he apologized in his own way. He was a good friend. And he was friendly to everybody. And that was his gift, his blessing to us. As a friend, he could be exasperating at times because you just wanted him to kind of move along here within the process. But he did what he loved to do. And what he loved to do was talk to people. And for that, I'm grateful to have known him because it helped me. When I came to this church in 1986, I thought I was pretty friendly, but I'd never been in a Florida church before. Holy mackerel, you know, we shook hands up north in Chicago. None of this, you know, they throw you on the floor and stomp on you and greet you and hug you and kiss you. And whoa, I wasn't ready for that. So I got to tell you one other funny story. This reminds me, when he first started coming to the church, he'd been there before I arrived, but when I noticed him, we became friendly, but not real close friends. And he went back to Los Angeles. He was gone for a month. He came back. And as was my wont, I would be in front before service talking to people and greeting visitors and so on and so forth. And I said, oh, CJ, you've come back. You look so rested from your vacation. Why, it looks like you had a face job. You got the picture. Well, I figured it was, I better make friends with him at that point, you know, for survival. He's a dear friend. I've got other stories that I would love to tell, but my voice will run out shortly. And you'll forgive me if I have to slip out early. I don't know. I'm not used to, anyway. We're working on this, but I wouldn't have missed this for all the world. And I appreciate him so much. And I'm going to check my notes. You know how modern we are, we put them on the phone now. I think you've told everything there is to tell, nothing that I can think of. Except to say that that great theologian and possible presidential candidate, Oprah Winfrey, she said lots of people want to ride with you in the limo, but what you want is someone who will take the bus with you when the limo breaks down. And that was CJ. He could be as high Anglican proper as he would outdo me, and that's doing a lot, because you know me, I'm smells and bells all the way. But he could get down and just when he was needed, and he was there in the crunch, in the time of need. And for that I say, God bless you, CJ. Rest in peace, and we'll see you sooner or later. I'm still working on making it later, but who knows. And God bless all of you. Amen.
Thank you.
Please rise as you are able.
Let us affirm the gospel message.
I believe in God, the good,
and in the message and mission of God's anointed prophet, Jesus the Way Shower, who was born of Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was executed for empowering the powerless and restoring the dignity of the marginalized. Yet he lives in our hearts and ministry. I believe in the omnipresent power of divine love, in the blessed community, in the sacred value of all people, and in life without end. Amen. For our brother CJ, let us pray. Lord Jesus, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn today.
Hear our prayer.
You wept at the grave of your companion Lazarus. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Hear our prayer.
You promised paradise to the rebel on the cross near your own. You make the same promise to our friend today.
Thank you, Lord.
CJ loves serving at your open table. We rejoice to know that he is feasting at your heavenly table now.
Hallelujah.
Comfort us in our sorrow, and let us remember that to God, all are alive.
And so it is.
Joining hands and hearts, let us continue praying in song using the words Jesus taught us.
Planning memorial and celebration of life services, there is always the question, will there be communion? For some reason, that question never came up this time. We just knew that for CJ's service, there would be the sacrament of Holy Communion. And so we do celebrate this Eucharist this afternoon to the glory of God and with special intentions for the repose of CJ's soul. The Apostle Paul wrote, "The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a sharing of the love of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a sharing in the life of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf." On the night of his betrayal and arrest, the Lord Jesus took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body. Do this in memory of me." And in the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant. Do this as often as you drink it in memory of me." Would you please pray with me? Dear God, please bless these elements of grape and grain and may we be blessed in the sharing of them as we remember the life and ministry of the Lord Jesus, and as we remember CJ, who loved Jesus. Amen. Here at the Sunshine Cathedral, we practice an open communion. And what that means is you don't have to be a member of this church or of any church to receive the sacrament. Just as you are with whatever your beliefs or doubts may be, you're welcome to participate in this feast of unconditional love. And so, my friends, these are the gifts of God for all the people of God.
Oh Lord, my God, when I am
Holy One, we give thanks that at this table you have fed us with spiritual food and offer us grace equal to every need. Amen. I invite you to please rise as you're able.
We have had a mixture of sort of grand, great hall songs, and also evangelical praise music. And we picked the ones that CJ liked the most, or that he seemed to like the most. He never told us, but there were those that got his hands up faster than others. And so he liked things grand and very Roman, but he also could shout out an amen, and he loved evangelical choruses also. So he got his way today. He got it all. He got communion, and he got stories about him, and he got his some of his work featured, and beautiful flowers, and beautiful people who loved him. I think this has been a good send-off for him, and I hope that he would have been pleased. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Give rest, O God, to your child, CJ, with your saints where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful God, we commend our dear CJ, knowing that you acknowledge him as a lamb in your own fold, a soul made in your image and held forever in your divine heart. We rejoice to know that you receive him in your arms of safety and into the glorious company of the saints in light. May he rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen. Following the benediction, Barb will play a postlude, and you're welcome to file by and say goodbyes. And then there is a repast prepared in the social hall. So if you'll just go through this door and keep going, there's food. And of course, CJ would have loved for you to share food with him. So thank you for coming today. I think it's been an hour well spent. I hope it has brought closure and healing wherever it was needed, and certainly honor to the one we've remembered. And now, my friends, may the blessing of God, creator, redeemer, and sustainer, be with you and remain with you always. Amen.